For those of you who are just now looking up and wondering why Chuck Moulton looks so strange, let me say that I'm not Chuck Moulton. I'm a temporary stand-in. So on his behalf, and on behalf of the Fresno Poets Association, let me welcome you to this program. There are a couple of announcements I would like to make. There will be refreshments after this evening's program in the lobby. And on January 2nd, there will be our next reading. Christopher Buckley will be here from Philadelphia, and Yarbrough will be here reading. That will be on a Thursday evening, January 2nd, here. This evening's program is, like many others, a combination program, partly a reading of poetry, partly music. It's been the same on a number of other occasions. This is a bit unique insofar as it's given over almost totally to the Jansen family, mother and daughter, celebrating the sister muses of poetry and music. And so it's, I want you to note, a politically correct program these days and such. I want to introduce first Jean Jansen, say a few things about her work. One of the questions that's frequently asked of a poet is simply, what are your poems about? It may not be the best question, of course, and yet it recognizes a need for some common ground of experience. If then I may be presumptuous enough to answer for Jean Jansen, I might say that very often her poems are really about love, or to be more exact, they are about the acts of loving. Sometimes loving is a matter of frank sexuality, the rope sizzling inside, or its human image mirrored in the night-blooming jasmine that unspirals itself to whatever flutters against it. And sometimes it is a nurturing, maternal love, the hands bringing mustard and tea in the feverish dark, yet wise enough to know that finally nothing covers us. And sometimes it is a loving that is inseparable from our profound yearning for transcendence, for beauty that returns our gaze, the veils pushed aside and revealing the golden eye with its holy, holy. And in speaking this way, I have, of course, distorted her work for the sake of brevity. I've simplified the variety of her poems. More important, I've given the impression that she writes about the various modes or facets of love as if these were distinct and separate, and such is not the case. In our era of increasing fragmentation and technological divisiveness, hers is a poetry that speaks of love as the central core of our being, a radical wholeness that radiates outward and does not fence off boundaries between what is sacred and what is profane, what belongs to the body and what to the spirit. And it is her images that finally tell us what these poems are about. Earthly, rooted images, fruits, flowers, seeds, stalks of wheat, trees, but everywhere, and often in the same poems, wings opening out, knots unloosening, transparencies, time out of time, kindling the next breath. Gene Jansen.
Thank you, Peter. I would like to begin with a poem which takes its impulse from a painting, and probably more than one of Vermeer's paintings, the Dutch 16th century miraculous painter, who took the very ordinary, even the housewife, and made something extraordinary out of it. Entitled, Vermeer Had It Right. Vermeer had it right, I think, the woman with a jug, a common kitchen, the light. Farther south, angels erupted in lightning skies, saints rose on clouds, mothers strained their arms upward, their eyes wild. Oh, I know when my child lies dying, I want the breakthrough. And those days when everything scrapes and pulls me down, and yet the simple rituals of the house, the washing up, the kneading, the rising, the jug of water holding the day's light, the miracle. The word float and the desire to float seems to come up rather often in my poems. And I guess Peter made reference to that, this desire for wings. This poem is something, I think, about the act of creating poetry itself, a process of sorting out what is true, maybe at least less false than so many times things are for us, and about that difficulty. Float. When I jumped, my body opened and fell into the emptiness, fast and soundless, until the rip and flap of the parachute, the float, the fields rising up to meet me. But this is a lie. It was my son who told me, I'm going fishing, and then jumped into those clear columns of air. Who can bear to tell the truth or hear it? All night long, the torrent in your ears, rush of wind before you find shelter. But in the half-light of dawn, you almost believe that the air holds you, dreaming again of the stranger who rescues you from the crowd, then lifts you in a joyful float above the city, hair flying, cheek against his coat, until the sun burns through the last veil. Then the body falls, full weight, and the voices grow dim. Songs about letting go, about fishing in the sky. And I have dedicated that poem to my son, Scott, who told me at the age of 17 that he was going fishing. Many of you know of my interest in Russia because of my grandparents immigrating from there, and one pair has died and is buried there. And my father came from there as an orphan teenager in 1910. We were privileged to visit there in 1975. And although we've gone back and in fact found some of the cousins, and I've read poems about that, this poem I wrote after the first visit, I think, still holds true, and it was one I wanted to read this evening. It's part of the Upside Down Tree and is in Piecework, This Moonlit Night. It's in five sections. Golden onions high among the barren trees. What we put into borscht is gilded and mounted on church towers, and at the Tsar's summer house, deep blue with golden stars. four evangelists around the large center onion of Jesus, clear profiles against the clouded sky, the stories that we peel layer after layer, our eyes smarting with the earthy fragrance, the tang of the mystery. The ancient monastery stands in a sprinkle of snow, stone crosses, steps, thick walls with openings for the view. I imagine the monks looking down on the winding river and the small villagers. One remembers his mother's back as she bent over the oven for the loaves. He thinks how he was conceived in hunger. He wonders that we eat Christ's body with our bodily appetites, even for our absolution, here on this windy hill, each of us hungering for another. Those crushed kernels of self-giving, that intimacy which feeds us. Too early for troikas, they say, and so we walk on the muffled streets, in the snow that falls on the Kremlin wall, on Lenin's tomb, on Ivan's church, on his great bell that never rang. It falls on the potato stand, on all the women waiting in line, on the evergreens, on my hair. It falls, and we walk in the snow because the troikas aren't running yet. Winter is not quite here, and the wolves are not hungry enough to begin their howling in the distant woods. Drifting off to sleep, you imagine the next day, what has been planned for you. Nothing to decide. Key woman in the hall watching the doors, doorman watching the other doorman. No moon, no responsibilities. Like a child, you are free to sleep and dream, and like a child, you will dream the bittersweet dreams of growing up. You will dream that the key woman is opening all the doors, and when the fire breaks out, if you choose the right one, you will escape. These stands of birches are like music on a page, or music itself, the delicate branches drooping and swaying among the straight trunks of paper white. At night, thick by the roadsides and around country houses, they help erase the darkness. I think of the women and children, the grandfathers who tried to hide among them, how they were pushed from cattle cars onto the empty steppes of Kazakhstan, how some survived on field mice in their earthen huts. Listen to that music. Chekhov's Masha walks among the trees. We must live, she says. And the new generation of birches grows whiter even in this moonless night. The next couple of poems are drawn from childhood experiences. The first one more from adolescence, I guess, that is part of childhood, and the most dramatic part so often. This poem is centered around a time that was particularly dramatic because our family made a move. And I think dislocation like that always sharpens the memories and the images so much. In addition to moving, my father entered college, and he and my mother agreed to be dorm parents in a men's dorm. And that was certainly added to the drama. The poem is entitled Facets. All the way from the Nickelback Cafe, past the college to home, the block of ice shimmered in its growing puddle. The wagon wheels stirred up the hot dust of September. Now Father slides it into the icebox, thud of the door, sighs as he leans once more over the doctrine of Christ and the required genetics. 50, already gray, he has brought us on his journey of learning. To know the truth, to hold it up and examine it like sun on crystal. This is the year I turned 13, the year of my catechism. What are the attributes of God, the five steps to salvation? The sun spins over the men's dorm where we live, scorches the elms, clamors against the window panes. At night, cicadas drill their urgencies and the college men shout and gallop on the stairs. I can hardly hear my own heart. Its din of voices calling to my father to rescue me from the baptismal waters. In the shadowed kitchen, he is bending over books, and drop by drop, the ice redefines itself in the dark. Among the darkness and fears of my childhood, some very bright things as well, and I thought surely I should give them some attention. And among them was a vibrant and colorful school teacher. While I have camouflaged some names of those people who frightened me, this is a woman who is keeping her true name in this poem. Anna Rieger at the blackboard. She's retired in Winnipeg now. As her stick men warred on the chalk green hills, her body swayed from army to army. Gideon blew his trumpet, and with one swish of the eraser, thousands fell, and her crepe dress shivered. Her blue chalk and a side swoop taught us grace. Moses' water cascading out of a rock struck right. Once in the girls' room, we found her bent over, brushing her hair, all tumbled now out of its bun. When she lifted herself up to the mirror, her face was flushed and strung. Her comb held high, she parted the brown silk and caught it again, pushed the door open with one full hip, and entered the crowded halls. And we followed, girls and boys, as on both sides the sea wall stood, clear and bright and quivering. I've been noticing that food has been creeping into my poems more and more. Some of you who know me well understand this. I don't know. Right, I think fruit comes most often. It's probably because it sits there, sort of serene and heavy, satisfied, I don't know. But also, my study's right off the kitchen, and it's a real temptation. So this poem that I wrote, it's probably one of the first poems I wrote about food. And some of you know it, Peaches in Minnesota. That's a commentary, I think, about the contrast of the way we use fruit in Minnesota and California, but maybe more so about the 40s and the 80s. Mrs. Nachtigall, Mrs. Peters, and Mrs. Thiessen, each in their separate steamy kitchens, ripped the slats off the perfect rows of peaches and said as they bent over, plump and panting, not to eat a single one fresh. These rows of peach buttocks, the skins turning rosy after the long train ride from California in the refrigerated miracle car, were now in the hands of Mrs. Nachtigall, Mrs. Peters, and Mrs. Thiessen, who said, no, not one. First, the scalding dip to slip off the furry skins, then the quick slice to take out the pit, the careful slide and pour into the mason jars, the steam bath until the lids snapped in with their safe seals, and then the shining rose on the drain board, breasts of peaches under glass to be brought up from the dank cellar when it was time. The syrupy flesh delicious in the mouth as snow ticked against the windows, cherished like the low sun of January, altogether different from California, where we eat them ripely sweet from the trees all summer long. Whenever we have the urge, and as many as we want, even as the fallen ones rot in the hot furrow, and the air conditioner hums and hums in monotone. A love poem for my husband of 37 years, Dusty Miller Moth. You came like a dusty miller into my mother's spotless kitchen, and with your soft wings circled the light of me. You came like a cloud of dusty millers, crowding with velvet sheddings among swung brooms, scorching against the star of my body. And when the door opened wide, you filled all my rooms so that the dark grew pale with flutterings, and we lay husked and floating in a stream that turns the night wheel, that grinds the ripe and gathered grains. Our first years of marriage tested some of the romantic stuff. We lived in Chicago. Not the nicest part of it either. It was the time when Lewis was in medical school in Chicago, and I think that those of you who know the city will understand that it is one which tests the strongest. Chicago, 1954. So glad you are safe and cared for now, my father writes to me, newlywed and in Chicago, his black script leaning away. We laugh, and I fold the letter as the L scrapes along the backbone of the south side where we live. Bullet holes in the glass of our front door, our tire slashed, and then the pharmacist murdered at the corner. Almost lakefront, this neighborhood. Yet nothing but pavement and rocks at the end of 47th, where the water laps and batters. Lake and wind, a wild pair shining and cutting by turns, the wind riding the sooty wing of the steel mills, then scouring the sky with its next breath. Life, it swallows you, the butcher announces, waving his knife, then handing us a bologna wafer to taste, as we leap into the rot and ice of the street. Breathe in and out, you tell the child, and listen through your stethoscope for the sweet exchange of air. And I lean over a typewriter printing words under the heart's tea waves. In the evenings, our lips and hands search for that current that could carry us above the sirens of the street. But even there, death's face asking for love. There is no safety, I could have written my father, but he knew that, knew the howling winds and the way water rushes into the ears. It's underwater where you learn to trust God, he would say. You hold your breath and body against its cold blade, as now I listen for your familiar footsteps after the long alley, the opening and closing of three doors, the turning of your key. Movement of vaulted chambers, a poem taken, the title is taken from the title of a watercolor by Paul Klee. Among the crowded upright columns are two that lean. They form an arch where nothing is still. The cut pile stones vibrate against each other in bright orange and blue. Stones, I said, and yet translucent. Sections of sheerness that could fold and fall, but are held even as foundations shift, as the purple sun rolls and the hills slide up to the moon. So much of my life has been given to mothering the four children, so that the poems are inevitable. In fact, Peter Everwine helped me weed out, I think, at least a half dozen out of the upside down tree, and we still left some. So they're there, and they come, and here's a short one about it, entitled Liftoff. When cooking, the word is light, Aunt Viola says. meringue like angel's wings, dinner rolls that lift off, the southern fried gliding, all of it fuel for takeoff. My baby is watching, stomach down, head up, her limbs swimming. Don't go, we cry at the end of the runway, as they waft above crops and woods, then land and rise again. My breasts overflow, so much is needed for the constant motion, for even the simplest gesture. The infant's hands soft as moths that turn and flit away into the stratosphere of night. As you know, I live in a medical dental family as well as one that is involved in the arts. And in the poem I'm going to read, I make reference to Vesalius, who was really the first to do an objective and careful study of the human anatomy, rejecting some of the myths that had hung on from Greek times and earlier. This poem also reflects the time when I was working in the hospital as a secretary, and one of my jobs was to release bodies from the autopsy room. And so I had that rather strange and awesome experience. Put me in touch with my husband's work, although he was going to keep them alive. I want to make that clear. And he did. The gardens of the body. 1535 in Paris, Vesalius tells the truth about the body, labels each glistening part, then in Padua sets it all down. Fabrica, he called it, the wondrous interweaving of nerve, bone, and blood, a garden to be named, each fruit and flower patterned for itself and the other. I have watched a surgeon reach into the plum-rich heart as it pumped, a tiny blade on his forefinger for the stony valve, and witnessed the ashen skin whirl pink as dawn. But also in autopsy, the skin laid back like lily petals, vital centers drying. The pathologist sat beside, eating a sandwich and listening to the sweet sound of his pulse. I fear my body crushed or stopped, this fabric scrim which falls, the way a garden falls, the way one fleshy pear falls, holding within it an entire tree, the sucking roots, the bridal bloom, and the light, which, in Vesalius, glowed in a place he never could find. Identifying the fire. Sometimes at night it blooms in our heads like marigolds and coxcomb in the cooling garden, a flare at the end of a long lane where the ruts finally meet. Lover's Lane, where my sister and I carried our dolls, covering their faces. Lips like fire, someone said, and we felt a rope sizzling inside. Our Sunday school teacher said it was the Holy Ghost hovering, beating its wings over us so that every body cell would glow. All our years, a fire consuming, giving itself away. We pass it on to our children, our voices full of love and warnings, like our own mothers bringing mustard and tea in the feverish dark, their hands both soothing and electric. Even in old age, they cradle a burning as they lean over pots of geraniums and break off the stems to help them bloom. All night, the petals scatter over them, and they stir as though toward another, someone who once entered them, a time out of time kindling the next breath, and at its far end, branches gesture. and windows. And it seems that we have find it impossible to keep out what's growing inside and what's living out there. It's partly our fault, because especially in the summers, we keep our doors open for air at night and all sorts of things come in. But it's a house with many trees and bushes and vines, and I love the feeling of it. And at times, though, it gets out of control. I knew it was a poem there, and I've known for 10 years that there was a poem. And I hope this is one. It is a reflection, I also, of what I feel is happening in our world. Toward the end of the century, worst is the ivy, which works its way through a window crack when I turn my head, then pushes a pale arm through the drapery. Good, proper English ivy turned to forced entry. But also the creeping fig, at first so demure, has grown hungry and large, etches the brick and window glass with a million hands. I open the door for air and the moths swarm in. One night, a baby possum at the doorstep, one paw up, courteous. Even after the garden shears and the locked doors, honeybees continue to claim the chimney, generation after generation, filling it with their tiny rooms, snarling angrily when we try to gas them out. And when I play Chopin's Prelude in A-flat, some fly in to the sudden sun of the piano light, scorching their wings as they repeat with me the one essential tone, the search for resolution. And I'm going to end with a couple of Christmas poems and one for my daughter, who will be singing. The first one is really for St. Nicholas Day. When we were in Poland this last summer in Gdansk, we visited the St. Nicholas Church one morning when we went for a walk. It was a 6:30 Mass. And I had the sense that the place was rocking. Maybe it was the hour. But I think it had something to do with the streamers that were hung for a special festival. And the beauty of the place, it was glistening with morning light. I use a word here, which I repeat. It's a Polish word, which means rocking. Read that at the very end. St. Nicholas Church, Gdansk. Morning Mass in St. Nicholas. And the church is rocking. It is a ship on the swells with ribs of black marble and gilded railings. We are rocking, Nicholas of the sailors, in your giant shoe filled with licorice and jelly beans. And you are scattering pieces of gold to save our daughters. As your ship lists and sways, the old women stumble in the aisles, swinging their string bags. Nicholas of the great red lap, the soft bearded whispers, Kovisash, Kovisash. One of our family traditions is a birch log, which we get out during Advent. Lewis drilled holes into it so that we have a candle to light for every day, starting on the 1st of December. We usually turn out the light and light the additional candle around dinner time. And naturally, it grows brighter and stronger through the season as we get closer. The poem is entitled Prayer at the Advent Log. The small lights steady against the dark, your flame touching ours. Today is the fifth day. It is a safe fire, the candle still tall above the brittle wood of the birch, the air damp and chill. But the days will draw us inexorably toward your celebration, and again we'll stand in the crackling air, the first day's flames licking the log with their shortened lives, the length of it threatened by your fire. Your love dazzling our eyes, and, O Christ, your light searing our nakedness. And finally, a poem which is for my daughter, Jill. It's another floating poem, but has more to do with singing. It's entitled Today. I do refer to a painting by Chagall and to his wife, Vava, in the painting. Today, Adam's rib is light. Full of love, I float up to the ribs of the cathedral in easy vertical line, and the sun floats down, colors the pale pillars, ignites a saint's carved curls, even the wings of gargoyles and the sword over the stone-bent couple at the gates. And today, Chagall's fish still flies, dragging the clock. His angel, heavy with breasts, stays aloft. But the floating lovers lie at last in Vava's lap. Her face is green with life, and when she lifts her ribcage to sing, the inner plumb line stretches and the lead weight swings. Thank you very much.
It's also Jean's birthday in a couple of days, so happy birthday. Celebrate the word reading. Poets seem forever infatuated with the concept of singing, the verb to sing. In poems, birds sing, of course, but so do things like chimneys, shoes, fish. Practically anything sings. Mostly, of course, poets sing, even when they're composing to the one note of a typewriter or a word computer, they announce, "I sing." It almost seems as if some part of poetry is always wanting words to lift up their heavy luggage of meaning and disappear into the pure transparencies of song. Almost 200 years ago, William Blake was writing out his cycle of songs, songs of innocence, and later the songs of experience. At that time, Blake stood at the very beginnings of the Industrial Revolution. And as he looked down the long corridors of time, he was pretty much appalled by what he saw. And the songs bear witness to that. In the late 1950s, Ralph Vaughan Williams, the English composer, took the words of his songs and made them into melodies, into his own songs. Marriage of words, of music. And tonight, 200 years later, at a time when we are well into the Industrial Revolution and perhaps do not quite know exactly where we are at this point, We have Jill Jansen singing the song of Blake around 1 billion. A moment ago, Jean Jansen took the human voice and moved it into the rhythms and rituals of speech, poetry. And now, another Jansen is to take the human voice and to move it from the rituals of poetry and speech into the music of song. She'll be accompanied by Rachel Aldrich, the oboist. I'd like to present Jill Jansen.
But today, oh, what shall I call? chimney sweepers cry, every blackening church appalls, and the hapless soldier sigh runs in blood down palace walls. But most through midnight streets I hear